All right. Thanks again for your patience. I just got this laptop 2 weeks ago, so who knows? So again, my name is Ray, and you can see my Twitter handle there if you wanna connect with me or DM me. I've been at GitLab almost 15 months now, so not that long. Although we've gone through a lot of changes since I joined. I mean, I think when I started, we were at about 300, 350 people. Now we're well over 850, so we've more than doubled in size. So it's kind of, I mean, it's a good problem to have and to a certain extent, but it's been a fun journey. And before GitLab, I was at the Linux Foundation for about 4 years. I didn't have a full-time community management role, but a bulk of my time was probably working with various communities in the networking industry. What I've noticed in the past 3 or 4 years, the community management, you see a lot of community manager types in different open source communities. When I started, I think a lot of people were doing this sort of on the side, like I was doing. Like, you didn't necessarily have like a full-time person getting paid to do a community management role. Like, you had a lot of people sort of volunteering. You may have like several people in the community working as a team of community managers. And I don't know, like, how many of you know John O'Bacon? He's like pretty well known in community management space. He's a great guy. He runs once a year. He runs a community leadership summit a weekend before OSCON. I mean, he took a break this year because I think he was just getting he was just overworked this year. But when I first went to CLS in 2016, a lot of the discussion was, I mean, community managers, like, how do I justify what I do? How do I justify my role to upper management or even to the community at large? So that was sort of the discussion in 2016. A lot of the, like, a breakout session, there were a lot of talks about that. When I went back 2 years later, the discussion evolved more into where, like, what's a career path for community managers? And then which group do the community managers belong to? Does it fit under VP of engineering? Is it marketing or is it something else? So it really grew into like almost like a full-time professional role, which was great to see as, I mean, one of the person that's really passionate about community management. So the byproduct of that is now you're just like every other colleagues, like in marketing, like in DevRel. So you go through a lot of these like a performance management discussions with your managers. I mean, not because you're going to get fired, but you know, like you're a full-time professional. You know, I started at GitLab June of last year. Like December, January, sort of our performance. That's when we annual performance discussion happened. So I started thinking about this. Like, since June of last year, like, what did I do? Like, did I make an impact in the community? Maybe I was going through a midlife crisis too. But I asked that question on, like, you know, how do I sort of discuss like what I've accomplished over the past 6 or 7 months? And I've talked to other community managers, and I've seen a lot of, read a lot of articles. And what I've noticed was that there's a lot of focus on discussions on metrics. Like, I mean, there are a lot of metrics in open source communities, like how many developers you have, how many commits you've gotten. But what I realized was that a lot of what we do, it can't necessarily be measured or very easily anyways. It's not easily quantifiable. So you need to have a lot of thinking into those aspects of your job that's not easily quantifiable. So I want to spend bulk of the time having a discussion about that. I want to make sure I know I got a little late start, but also want to have plenty of time for discussions towards the end, or I'd love to have hallway conversations as well. So what's our job? I mean, this is not a complete list of what we do. So I broke it into like two groups. Like, one on your left is our aspect of our jobs that's relatively easy to sort of quantify, or you see plenty of metrics. Things like, you know, is there growth in the community? Are there active number of developers? However you want to quantify it in your community, I mean, that's relatively easy to measure. Things like how many people you onboarded, either through like things like sprints that you do at KDE or onboarding sessions that some of the communities do. I mean, a lot of communities do sort of some sort of a health assessment using metrics and numbers. And I think, like, I mean, I've heard some of the discussions already here. This is my first Academy, but you always obviously go through like a lot of process improvements. even if it's things like improving your wiki page and making onboarding easier. I mean, a lot of that could be easily measured in terms of like numbers and metrics. But the things on your right, I mean, that's my obligatory cute baby picture or toddler picture, is like a lot of the stuff that you do is like not easily quantifiable. Like, am I creating a welcoming environment for a lot of people, like a lot of new people to join? And that's not necessarily easily quantifiable. I mean, there are some metrics that people use, but I think those just tend to scratch the surface. And one of the things that I like to do as a community manager is that I need to be representative of the community. Like within GitLab, like, I mean, we have thousands of contributors that are contributing to GitLab that are not employed by GitLab, but I need to be their voice, right? How am I doing that effectively to my management and to my colleagues? And that's not easy to quantify necessarily. I mean, you can talk to our members and see what kind of job I'm doing, but that's, you can't necessarily put a score on that. And the final thing, and this is an important one, especially open source communities, I mean, members join your community because it meets their intrinsic needs. A lot of people aren't getting paid to contribute to an open source project, but for whatever reason, they're passionate about the technology, or they're passionate about, you know, what your community stands for. What you really need to do is that making sure that you're satisfying their intrinsic motivation for whatever reason they chose to join your community in the first place. And that's really hard to quantify. But I mean, that's one of the things that I try to ask myself now and then and say, am I making a difference? So with a lot of communities, we have a lot of metrics at GitLab. And this is sort of the dashboard. I mean, I worked with Biturja for a long time, even when I was at the Linux Foundation. But this dashboard is still like a work in progress. I mean, this took like months to build. I mean, it wasn't like I hired Biturja and we had all this data to analyze the data. And the reason why I point this out is that when I was at Community Leadership Summit last year, after my presentation, somebody came up and said, can you recommend four or five metrics that I can use for my community? And my answer to that was like, well, it really depends. I mean, it's not really that simple. Like, I don't have four or five golden metrics that you can use for every community. But it'll depend on the community. But even within the same community, the type of metrics that you look at might be very different, like a year from now. Just as an illustration, I mean, when I first joined, I first wanted to know who these people were. Like, I mean, we have a lot of people outside of GitLab that are contributing, but it wasn't necessarily easy to figure out who these people were. So identifying them, how much contribution we're getting over a time period. And I mean, sorry, this might be a little hard to read. Like, I focus on like a median open days. So are we doing a good job like closing the merge requests that are coming in from outside of the community? I wanted to compare between median open days for MRs that were opened by GitLab employees versus people from outside of the company. I knew there would be a difference, but I wanted to make sure that for GitLab employees, it was 2 days, but for people outside, it's like 25 days. That would not be acceptable. But I mean, luckily, the range of like open days that I've seen have been pretty decent. So this is like some of the metrics that I focus on in the early days. It's not that these aren't important anymore, but my focus areas are different today. I mean, the chart on your right, this is sort of the backlog, a cumulative backlog that we've had over the period. One of the reasons why I looked at that was, like I mentioned before, we more than doubled in size. I mean, especially in engineering, has that made any impact in the backlog? That's one of the things I wanted to see. And the other thing I looked at recently was, a great thing about our community is that we have a lot of our customers that are making contributions to GitLab in terms of code. I mean, they find it easier to change, fix a bug or add a new feature by doing the work directly, versus just, you know, opening an issue and hoping somebody would pick it up. So I wanted to, closely identify who those customers were in amongst like a community of contributors. So, I mean, it took a couple of slides, but the point is, like, even in terms of like a metrics, stuff that are easily quantifiable, that what you look at today you may not look at it as closely like next year. You might have different areas or different processes that you want to focus on. So just want to leave it at that and talk about what I mentioned before. So what about things that are not easily measured? And I listed some of the possible scenarios. Like I mentioned, like, do we have representation from underrepresented communities? I mean, not just in terms of like people like committing code, but things like if you go to an event like this, you know, is it basically all guys talking at conferences? And that's usually not a good thing to see. You want to have like a fair representation from different groups. I mean, that's in some aspect that could be measured. But I mean, I went to a session a couple of weeks ago, and it was titled How to Be a Good Ally. And one of the things, the speaker from Autodesk, his name is Guy Martin, I've known for a while. One of the things he talked about was that we tend to focus too much on like speaking, but we also need to encourage people from underrepresented communities to sort of lead like initiatives or projects within open source projects, which I didn't even think about. So, I mean, there are other areas that we probably could look at or set new goals for. Because, I mean, good example is, we want to restructure the wiki, but should you volunteer yourself or do you want to find some other people that you think would be pretty good at like leading the new effort rather than having the same four or five people like leading new initiatives within your community? So I thought that was like a really, good example of how we can enlarge participation from different community members. The third and fourth bullet here sort of goes into intrinsic motivation. So does a charter or the mission still reflect what a lot of people believe in? You start with the mission for your project or goals, but you know, does it still make sense or does it need to do a better job of reflecting like new members of the community? So that's something like you probably want to pay attention to. And set some type of goal for. It's sort of associated with your mission and goals is your community code of conduct. I mean, community code of conduct, I think we've gotten to thinking this in terms of dealing with like, you know, abusive languages or even violations at events, but it community code of conduct really needs to reflect your community or your aspirations. That's something that you probably want to, I shouldn't be dealing with community code of conduct when there is a foul language that's happening on forums or at events. So some of these like scenarios that I talked about that's hard to measure. One of the reasons why it's hard to measure is that it's not as easy to get feedback on how well we're doing in these areas. Surveys are great. Online feedbacks are helpful. But I think the challenge with that is like the surveys are helpful for like transactions. Like I'm buying your shoes or I flew on the plane and you get a survey on how my experience was. So it's easy to sort of quantify like a transaction, but in the community, it's not a transaction with somebody that I'm not going to meet. Like it's you're going to have a long-term relationship with these people. A better mechanism is like going to events like this and having hallway conversations or having one-on-one conversations. And one of the things I'm trying to get better at, as I'm getting, you know, well settled into my job is to having one-on-one conversations, even if it's over Zoom, with community members rather than just trying to sit behind like issues and merge requests to have a communications. I mean, it shouldn't be too much of a burden for me to spend a few hours a month like talking to different community members over the phone. So that's something that I'm trying to be better at and then get a better sense or get a better pulse from the community. I know I'm quickly running out of time. So how do we, like, you know, measurement for these areas are hard, but you should still set goals, right? I mean, trying to set a, you know, create an inclusive community. I mean, maybe what I need to do is do a better job of having people, like a new people, especially from underrepresented communities, like leading different initiatives in my community, or featuring them in a blog or during interviews. I mean, one of the things that I realized a couple of months ago was that a lot of the blog posts I was doing was featuring community members that were all, they were all guys. And that's a problem. It wasn't like, it wasn't something that I did it on purpose, but I realized that after a while, and it's, you know, that's something that's easy to fix, right? And as you work towards these goals, what you might want to try out, and what I'm trying to do, is do a different type of experimentation. I talked to somebody at Open Source Summit a couple of weeks ago, Jana Gallus. She's a professor at UCLA. She talked to me about doing different type of A/B testing when I reach out to contributors, even for things like recognition. It's like using different type of communication mechanisms or even different emails. So that's something that I want to try to do to make sure that, you know, how I communicate with community members or how I'm conveying the recognition or awards, there's a difference depending on which mechanism I choose. And, you know, and then once in a while, make sure that it's try and see what kind of impact those different type of experimentations have made and towards meeting those goals. Just want to leave you with two quick quotes. I don't want to like read through them, but I mean, basically, I mean, I kind of made this point. What I try not to do is focus too much on what's quantifiable, because just because it's quantifiable doesn't mean that it's important. And I mean, Simon Sinek is somebody that I didn't know about until about a month ago. I was just looking for a quote or graphics that shows that you need to focus on people, not numbers. And this quote just kept popping up. And if you haven't heard of Simon Sinek, I encourage you to find his YouTube video. He's like the third most watched person on YouTube, apparently, and I didn't even know about him. So I thought these were helpful quotes for me, a good inspiration. I know I'm out of time, but happy to take questions if you have time or can have a hallway conversation. Thank you.